In this video, we are going to discuss electrons and the periodic table. This covers the bulk of Chapter 3 within your textbook. The topics covered include light and waves, Bohr models, quantum mechanics and orbitals, electron configurations, and then periodic table basics, as well as periodic trends. Let's start by discussing what light is. Light is based on the movement of accelerated electrons. It travels at a speed of 3.0 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. It is said to have a dual nature because it can act like both a particle as well as a wave. Different types of light have different frequencies and energies. All this is on the electromagnetic spectrum. And there are some relationships that exist. As frequency of a wave increases, its energy also increases. So it's a direct relationship. As frequency of light increases, the wavelength, which is the crest to crest for any wave, decreases. So it's an indirect relationship. Let's briefly discuss what causes light. Electrons are going to get heated and become excited. When they get excited, they jump. They're going to jump up to a new energy level, but they're unstable there, just like you or I would be if we jumped up into the air. And then they fall back down, but now they had extra energy. They have to give off this extra energy. They have to release it. So this extra energy, as they fall down, is given off as light. So you can see here in the diagram that we have a ground state. That's the primary state for an electron. Any energy level above that is going to be an excited state. We are providing energy and exciting the electrons. That's what that little squiggly blue arrow is. And the electron jumps to a new energy level. But it's not happy. It's not stable there. So it falls back down, and as it falls back down, it gives off light. What you will notice with different elements is that they can produce different colors, and we'll see this in an experiment we'll be doing in class. So they give off different colors because the electrons have different frequencies and energies. Let's do a review, hopefully, of a Bohr model. These are very commonly taught in integrated science classes in high school. So in 1913, shortly after Rutherford made up his model of the atom and discovered the nucleus, Niels Bohr worked with him to correct the model. Bohr's model states that electrons are found in set orbits around the nucleus. So they're found on rings. And they're kind of like the planets around the sun. So electrons orbit the nucleus like planets around the sun. There were no in-between energies. Every orbit had an energy associated with it. And the higher the energy level, or the higher the number, excuse me, the greater the energy. So if you have energy level 3 versus energy level 4, energy level 4 is going to be greater in energy than energy level 3. And there were a set number of electrons that were on each ring. And usually it's 2, 8, 8, and then 18. You can see an example Bohr model with the electrons shown here. We now know that his model was also incorrect, and instead we follow something called the quantum mechanical model, which is the modern model of the atom. And we discussed that in previous videos. Let's turn our focus to actually electrons. Electrons have a negative charge. They have specific amounts of energy. There is a principle called the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which basically states that one cannot know both the momentum or the speed, and the location of an electron at the same time. And the reason for that is because electrons are disturbed by light. So these both cannot be known at the same time. So because of this, we're not entirely sure of exactly where electrons are at every given moment. So the electron cloud was instead developed, and we say that our electrons are found within orbitals. And these orbitals are regions where an electron can be found 90% of the time. As I was saying, your orbitals are regions where electrons can be found 90% of the time. Let's discuss electron location. Quantum numbers equal n. Okay, they are the energy level where the electron is found. These range from 1 through 7 because there are 7 periods on the periodic table. They are represented with actual numbers. We then have something called a sublevel, which includes our orbitals. The sublevels are the shapes, and the orbital tells us the orientation of that particular sublevel. These are represented with letters, and those letters are S, P, D, and F. And finally, we have electron spin. Electrons can spin clockwise or counterclockwise. There, we usually use arrows to represent this as up and down. We're going to kind of dive a little bit deeper into the different sublevels and orbitals on the next upcoming slides. The first type of orbital is an S orbital. You can see a picture of that here. There is one for every energy level. They start at energy level number one. They are spherical in shape. And they contain a maximum of 2 electrons. And these are called the 1s, the 2s, 3s, so on and so forth. If you were asked to compare a 4s to a 2s, your 4s orbital is going to be larger than your 2s, but because they are both an s, they would be the same general shape. P orbitals, there are 3 for every energy level. You can see them labeled here, PZ, PY, and PZ, PX, PY, and PZ, and here's all of them together. They start at energy level 2. They are said to be shaped like a dumbbell, and they can hold a maximum of 2 electrons each, so 2 times 3 equals 6, so you can have a max of 6 electrons within your P sublevel. And again, they're called 2P, 3P, so on and so forth. And once again, a 4P versus a 2P, 4P is going to be larger than a 2P, but just like the S's, they are going to be the same general shape. The next type of orbital is a d orbital. There are 5 within every energy level. They start at energy level 3. They don't really have a shape per se, so we usually go like that. But since there are 5 of them, 5 times 2, because that's how many electrons can go in each one, D can hold a maximum of 10 electrons, and again, they're the 3D, the 4D, so on and so forth. And you can see them over here. The F orbitals, there are 7 for every energy level. It's the 4th type of orbital. It starts at N equals 4. Again, they don't really have a set shape, or each of them is not the same, so we don't label a shape. And there are 7 times 2. So we're going to multiply those and get a maximum of 14 electrons. And these are called the 4F and the 5F. You are not going to have to draw any of these because technically they're superimposed on one another and they overlap. But we wanted you guys to get an idea of what they would look like in their 3D spaces. Let's kind of put all of that together into a summary slide. And then we'll really talk about what you're going to be doing with these electrons and their locations. So in energy level number 1, N equals 1, the only sublevels, remember these are the shapes and the letters, would be S. There's 1S orbital, and therefore it's a max of 2 electrons. N equals 2 has both s and p for its orbitals. There's one orbital for s, 3 for p. And then there's 2 electrons in the s plus a max of 6 in the p for a total of 8. Energy level 3, we have s, p, and d. So we have 1 orbital, 3 orbital, and 5. And then we have 2 electrons in the s plus 6 in the p plus a max of the 10 in the d. And we get 18. N equals 4 has all 4, s, p, d, and f. So it's 1, 3, 5, 7. Therefore, for electrons, it's 2 plus 6 plus 10 plus 14, and we get a max of 32. Now, let's talk electron location, kind of take some of this very abstract stuff that we've been talking about and make it a little bit more concrete. So electron configurations are what we're going to be using. They're kind of like a roadmap, and we're going to use numbers and letters to illustrate electron location and arrangement. As you can see, the slide is completed. So I did an example. The electron configuration for carbon, because carbon is element number 6, it'll have 6 electrons, is going to look like this. 1s2, 2s2, and then I need 2 more, so it's 2p2. You'll notice that these superscripts add to the atomic number. There is a set hierarchy and order. 1s followed by 2s followed by 2p, 3s, 3p, so on and so forth. You should be able to use the periodic table to help with this. That is found on the next slide. And your instructor will probably also review this with you in class. They are based on 3 key principles. The AFBA, totally said that wrong, principle, which says that the lowest energy level will always fill first. So 1s fills before 2s, which fills before 2p, which fills before 3s, so on and so forth. We have the Pauli exclusion principle that says 2 electrons max per orbital, and they have to have opposite spins. So one electron goes clockwise, the other counterclockwise. And finally, we have Hund's rule that says electrons of equal energy do not pair until they have to. So if you have 3p orbitals and you have 3p electrons, each orbital would get 1 before anyone gets 2. Let's practice this. So as you can see here, you have a periodic table that's been labeled with all of the different sublevels. Okay? And there's a couple of things I'd like you to notice. This right here on your periodic table is called the S block. And if you notice, other than helium over here, there are 2 elements in each section. And we know that S can hold 2 electrons. Over here, where the P block is, except for helium, if you count up your elements, you'll see that there are 6 elements in each section. Here is your D block. And if you count across, you'll see that there are 10 elements in each of those. And down here is your F block. And if you count, you'll notice there are 14 elements in each of those. The S's and the P's match up with the row number on the periodic table. So row 1 has just the 1s, row 2 has 2s and 2p, so on and so forth. And your D are off by 1. So row 4 has your 3d, row 5 has your 4d, and row 6 has your 5d. And then your F's are technically off by 2 because they actually fit in up here. So your 4F is found in, you know, next to your 6S. Okay. In the next video, we will go over these practice problems as well as talk about the periodic table.